So I see we have a very small but dedicated audience. So let me just explain the point of view because I think it's important. A bit cross-disciplinary. So if there is a little bit of mathematics which can be avoided, you don't feel I skip over it because I was not clear what kind of audience I would have. Okay, so basically I want to look at Newtonian physics, and I want to look at Poincaré's analysis of it, and I want to look at the current understanding of physics, current understanding of time in physics. And I want to look at the whole thing from a historical perspective. So the historical perspective has a slightly different point of view, which is that I'm looking at not just how metaphysics got in, but how religious beliefs and historical beliefs have influenced physics. This is the crux of the point that is being made. And this religious belief or historical beliefs, they travel into physics through the notion of time. And vice versa, that if you correct that, then you are able to lead to a better physics. That's the central idea. Okay. So, let's just look at Newton's laws of motion. So, I think everybody is familiar with that. That in the absence of external forces, a body continues in its state of rest or uniform motion in a straight line. So straight line motion is natural. That's what Newton would say. Now, as a matter of fact, straight line motion is not natural because in some time back, if you recollect, they looked at some pictures of Mars and they found that there were straight lines there. And they said, well, if there are straight lines, that is a sign that it's not natural, that it is made by some intelligent people, human beings. So straight lines are not natural, however, we let that pass. I want to look at the next part, which says forces, mass times acceleration. So forces, mass times acceleration, there are many technical questions about where you are measuring this force, whether you are moving, not moving, how you decide what kind of a frame you are in. There's a question about the word law. Whose law? Why does Newton call it a law? So I would set that aside for the time being. Maybe we can go into that while discussing. I'm just asking a very simple question. There is acceleration. And when does a body accelerate? When it is covering unequal distances in equal times. So in order to know what is acceleration, we should know what are equal times. But we don't know what are equal times. I mean, how do you define what are equal times? So equal lengths, I can put two things together and I can compare. But if I have time intervals, they cannot be put side to side and compared. So you need a definition. And the definition that Newton gave was a very strange definition. He said absolute, true, and mathematical time flows on regardless of anything external. Now look at the adjectives there. Absolute, true, mathematical. So this is all metaphysics. I mean, he's emphasizing the metaphysical nature of time. It's absolute, it is true, it is mathematical, not physical. It is something pure. And just in case you missed the point, he adds the fourth clause, that time flows on regardless of anything external. So why did Newton make time metaphysical? That's the question. He made time metaphysical. He said, I mean, basically what he says is that it flows on regardless of anything external. God knows what equal intervals of time are. It's not necessary for human beings to know it. they're not able to know it, because they said any measure of time that you take, whether days and nights, they are not of equal length, whether the oscillations of a pendulum, they are not equal times. Now, let us put it in a historical context to understand what exactly Newton was doing. So his teacher, Isaac Barrow, he had earlier defined time, equal intervals of time. And Barrow's definition is very interesting. He starts off by quoting Augustine, that famous statement, "What then is time? If no one asks me, I know." This is the way Barrow has quoted him. "But if any person requires me to tell him, I cannot." So what is this knowledge which cannot be told to the other person? Something strange. And Barrow rejected this. He rejected it very emphatically. He said that mathematicians, since they frequently make use of time, they ought to have a distinct idea of the meaning of that word. And otherwise, they are quacks. This was his statement, that since you are using time, you should know what it means. And if you don't know what it means, well, that's not a sign of a good mathematician or a physicist. So Barrow himself defined. He gave a very interesting definition. Equal causes or similar causes take equal times to produce equal effects. So if there is no change in the cause, then the same effect would be produced in the same amount of time. So for example, if I have a sand clock and I invert it, so he would say, well, the quantity of sand is the same, the size of the aperture is the same, and therefore the time for the sand to fall through will also be the same. Therefore, these time intervals are equal. Okay, so the causes remain the same, therefore the time intervals are equal. Now the point is that Barrow's definition is a physical definition. I can actually do something. It is part of physics. I can do something and I can make out that these are equal intervals of time. I have a clock, a physical clock. But Newton, although he comes after Barrow, he goes back to the metaphysics that Barrow rejected, which Barrow explicitly rejected. And the question is, why does he do that? And I don't think that question has really been asked before, and it has not been answered. So I would like to provide an answer, because I think that now the entire picture is sort of clear to me. It's a question of communicating it. So, basically there is no way to explain this on stock history. Because say Newton is this great genius who came, perhaps he was a genius, I'm not objecting to being a genius. But the point is, what is the process of creation? That is inexplicable. He came and he did this, and people kept quoting this definition of time for centuries without realizing what problem it creates. So he came and he did this and so on, and even now people tell me, I don't know, at some conference, not even a conference, this was in a discussion list. Oh, Newton did a very good thing by making time metaphysical. Now, the point is, there is this belief in authority which has been created in the authority of Newton. And that is not how history should be. History is about understanding the past. So whatever things people did right, whatever things people did wrong, we have to understand and we have to learn from that. It's not about glorification, not glorification of this or glorification of that. And basically, it's about contemporary things. So that is how one should be looking at history. So therefore, it's important to answer the question why, and this is the book that looks at it in some detail at what is happening. And I think he has got three of my books, but not this one, so I just thought I'd show you a picture. So the idea is that there is an issue that Newton has. And to understand the issue, we have to go back to the question of calculus, because to formulate Newton's laws, Newton uses the calculus. And so one has to understand the origin of the calculus, one has to get into the history of the calculus in order to understand why Newton gave that definition of time. So now this is more or less established that calculus in infinite series originated in India over a very long period, over a 1,000-year period. So that is what the book describes.
And of course, this starts in the 5th century Aryabhatta and goes on to the 15th century, where you have a lot of these infinite series, and this was long before Newton and Leibniz. So why was calculus developed in India? It was developed basically in order to calculate trigonometric values, and those trigonometric values were needed for the two principal sources of wealth. The two principal sources of wealth were overseas trade and monsoon driven agriculture. Agriculture was the key. So in order to do agriculture successfully, so maybe if we have some more time, I can show you some pictures about what happened this year, because a bad calendar was used and the monsoon was mistimed. And I can show you what happened 2-3 years ago, because even today, that calendar is a very critical aspect of agriculture, and if agriculture fails, it's a massive disaster for the entire country. And that happened this year, it happened a couple of years ago, and I have been objecting to it, saying that it's not the monsoon which is delayed, it's the calendar which is wrong. Let us see how successfully I can argue that with my government. But so governments are always very difficult to argue with. They have these massive structures and nobody understands anything. They're all just going by guesswork. So the point is that this was, calendar was very critical for agriculture, and to make a good calendar, planetary models were needed, and for that trigonometric values were needed. Overseas trade was important, for that navigation was important, for that trigonometric values were needed. So precise trigonometric values are needed, and that's the context in which the calculus develops from the 5th to the 15th century. There is increasing precision, starting from Aryabhatta, who gives trigonometric values precise to the minute. Then you go to Wateshwar around 9th century, who gives trigonometric values precise to the second. And then in the 14th century, Madhav, you have trigonometric values precise to the third, and then the whole process is explained. And we know that it was transmitted from Cochin, because the first Roman Catholic mission was founded in Cochin in 1500. And they set up a school for the local Syrian Christians. And that school was taken over by Jesuits around 1550, and then they expanded it. And they converted it into a mini Toledo, where they were taking large number of local texts, they were translating them, and they were sending them back to Rome. So that is all discussed in that book, how that happened and what is the... Well, the critical thing is there was a requirement for precise trigonometric values in Europe, because there was a big issue with the navigational problem. It was a problem which was being supported by large numbers of... by several governments. For example, the French Royal Academy started around the solution of this navigational problem. That's true also of the British Royal Society. And well, the Spanish government gave money, the Portuguese government gave money for it. So this process started from 1530 and went on till about 1750, when the British Board of Longitude gave its award, 1760 thereabouts. So this was basically that European navigational problem, which badly required trigonometric values, because if you look at the basic chart, Mercator chart, that's the common map of the world. So that, to construct that, you need what is called a table of seconds, and that was used, and that is why these things were taken up. Clavius was the key Jesuit at that point of time, and he was reforming the calendar, which happened in 1582. So his student was there in Cochin, and I have his handwritten letter, Matteo Ricci. Anyway, that's a separate story. We don't want to get into that. Key point I want to make is this, that there is a cultural difference. That the way calculus developed in India, it developed as part of Ganit. And this Ganit was not mathematics. Mathematics is derived from mathesis. Learning, it involves the soul. Because learning, according to Plato, is recollection of eternal knowledge of the soul. But this was a purely practical point of view in Ganit. There wasn't anything spiritual, there was nothing formal. It was very, very straightforward and practical. So, that was not understood. And therefore, when this infinite series came, there was a protracted epistemological struggle. What are these infinities and infinitesimals? How can you take them seriously? How can they be part of mathematics? On the other hand, there was clear-cut practical value. Because you could calculate trigonometric values, you could make a map, you could sail with it, and that was very important. So, well, you could formulate Newton's laws with them. That was what was done in the 17th century. So this is not something uncommon. This is something which frequently happens. When some knowledge from one culture goes to another culture, there's always a problem with adjusting to it. You know, it's never taken exactly. There are always some changes, there are struggles, there are misunderstandings. So this happened, for example, with the numerals. So when Pope Sylvester II, Gerbert, he first brings in the Arabic numerals, he has a problem understanding them, and that is very manifest. He writes those numerals at the back of counters and continues to use the abacus method, which is obviously not correct, because the point of the numerals is the place value system and not the way you write them. You can write them as you like. So anyway, this imported material took a long route. Clavius was the chief Jesuit at that point of time, looking after the mathematics in the Collegio Romano, and so it went to him, and he publishes trigonometric values table, two tables, 1586, 1608. 1608 table shows clear signs of Indian influence. 1586 is earlier thing which has been interpolated. And Tycho Brahe, who was the royal astronomer to the Holy Roman Empire at that point of time, who was also close to Clavius, he gets the astronomical material. His astronomical model is the same as the Indian planetary model of Nilkant. When Tycho Brahe dies, it goes to Kepler. Well, how he died was a mystery, but he kept his material secret from Kepler. And then Kepler is not able to understand it, he tries. Then the next person who picks it up is Galileo, whose access to Jesuit sources is clear, but he is not happy with it. And he passes it on to his student, Cavalieri. It's a little spelling mistake. And then it goes to Fermat, Pascal, and then it finally goes out to Newton and Leibniz, who are today given credit for it. So the point is, there was this struggle, you know. Let's work, for example, in the case of Galileo. So, Fermat and Pascal picked it up very enthusiastically. Said, you can solve this thing, you can do all sorts of stuff, you can do calculate the areas of parabolas of all kinds. But Descartes was not happy. So Descartes wrote something else. He was not at all happy with what Fermat and Pascal were doing. So that's not mathematics. So this is what he wrote, that the ratios between straight and curved lines are not known, and I believe cannot be discovered by human minds, beyond the human mind. And therefore, no conclusion based upon such ratio can be accepted as rigorous and exact, so it cannot be part of mathematics. This was Descartes' issue. Why not? So ratio of curve to straight line is the number pi. If I look at the circumference of a circle and divide by the diameter, but something is missing there. It should be Shulba Sutra.
Sutra.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So something's got swallowed up. I don't know how. Okay. So the point is, the Shulba is the rope, and so you use a rope, and you're able to measure the length of a curved line. It's the same as measuring the length of a straight line. I mean, one can argue about which technology is superior, but that is what appears to be. I mean. I really see no difference between measuring a straight line and between measuring a curved line. If you can measure one, you can measure the other. But because the length of a curved line made sense, it was meaningful, something you can hold in your hand. So very much part of the human mind, in fact, it can be held in your hand. So that facilitated the development of the calculus and the precise calculation of that number, because that's a critical aspect of the calculus. The number which is called pi, which is the ratio of the circumference to the diameter. And this is part of the traditional Indian school syllabus. It was called Rajju, rope. Still used by some people, but it has now degenerated to the level of carpenters. It is low-level knowledge, not high-level knowledge. Now the point is, Descartes axiomatically assumed that you have the straight line. The straight line is primary. And therefore, if I have a curved line, it does not by itself make sense. It has to be approximated by means of straight lines. And if I do that, if you make an approximate calculation within Ganit, it was completely acceptable. Or within a computer calculation, any calculation that I do on a computer is going to be only approximate, can never be exact. So that's acceptable. It's acceptable, it is fine for all practical purposes. But Descartes was not interested just in practical purposes. He was interested in mathematics. Mathematics must be perfect, it must be exact, and that is not possible even however small the approximation, however tiny the approximation. So he said, well, that's not possible. So the only way to do it is if your straight line must be so tiny, it must be infinitesimal, then you can allow that it is approximating a curved line. And if you have a straight line which is infinitesimally small, then if you have a finite portion of a curve, you must have an infinity of those infinitesimal segments. And therefore, you would need to sum up this infinity of infinitesimals in order to get the length of the curved line. And summing up this infinity of infinitesimals is a super task, and this is what he thought was beyond the human mind. So it's a perfectly reasonable position given his axioms. What you can challenge are the axioms. Starting from the axioms, starting from those beliefs, it is a reasonable position. But well, question is whether that straight line is the appropriate thing. So the two key beliefs were this: that geometry begins with straight lines, and that mathematics cannot make approximations. It has to be perfect. It's the language in which God wrote the world, and therefore it has to be perfect. It cannot be allowed to be approximate. It incorporates eternal truths, therefore it cannot be approximate. So those were beliefs that were specific to the European understanding of mathematics. They were not prevalent in India. And those are the two beliefs that are reflected in Newton's laws: the belief in the straight line, the belief in the perfection of mathematics. And that is the reason why Newton wants to make time metaphysical. Because he has a d by dt, so the first law could be restated that so long as something is moving in a straight line, it does not require an explanation. It's all right. And if it is deviating from a straight line motion, that has to be explained by means of a force. What is force? We do not know. We define it as mass times acceleration. You have to calculate it like that, and that involves a d by dt or a derivative. That's where the calculus comes in. And how does the d by dt make sense? Because that was the challenge that he faced. That is what his contemporaries criticized him for. That is what Descartes had objected to. So Newton looks at it and that entire debate, and then he says that for the d by dt to make sense, time must be infinitely divisible. But real time may not be like that. It may be moving by jerks or starts or whatever. It may not be smooth. Therefore, he had to make this axiomatic requirement that time flows on, whether or not time is really like that. And as a matter of fact, even today, the way it is done, in order for that d by dt to make sense, the mathematician will say that time must be like the real line. So that's a metaphysical stipulation. And that stipulation is required because you need the real line to have limits, and you need limits to define the derivative. So that metaphysics comes in through this requirement that mathematics must be perfect. And so we have brought in, we made time metaphysical because of this cultural requirement, which is not really a requirement of physics. Okay, so now let me just move on to Poincaré, where Poincaré looks at in his Measure of Time, which he did in 1898, and which is reproduced. I have access to only the translated sources, and I would love to have access to the original sources, which I do intend to take into account at some point of time. So basically he says you cannot find out what we have no direct intuition. Just as you have a direct intuition of same size, you have no direct intuition of same times. And anybody who thinks that is a dupe of an illusion. So then he says that what does it mean? So from 12 to 1 is the same time as from 1 to 2 or from 2 to 3. What meaning does this have? And he says, well, it has no meaning by itself. By itself it has no meaning. It has no intuitive meaning for people. Therefore, it has to be given a meaning. That meaning has to be given by means of a definition. And any definition you give will have some arbitrariness. A very reasonable position. What can be more reasonable than that? You have to do it. There is no way to perceive it, so you have to define it. And this definition will have some arbitrariness. So how is that arbitrariness to be resolved? Well, I'll just tell you that. He also rejects Barrow's definition. He says that, well, we are not quite sure that the causes are exactly the same. They may be approximately the same. So he says causes almost identical take almost the same time to produce almost the same effects. This is critical to what happens when he gets in the theory of relativity. So how to get rid of the arbitrariness is, this is his principle, that you define it in such a way that the equations of physics are as simple as possible. So that's the criteria. You can always do something different, you can make the equations of physics more complicated, but you don't want to do that. You want to keep them simple, and therefore you define equal intervals of time in that way. And what does that mean? At that point, the critical issue was the conflict between electrodynamics and Newton's laws. And Newton's laws conflict with electrodynamics, they conflict with thermodynamics. So you have to resolve that conflict. So the way to resolve the conflict with electrodynamics was to postulate that the speed of light is a constant. And this is what Poincaré did. Because he said, if you postulate that the speed of light is a constant, then you are able to resolve this conflict. Okay, you are able to, if I postulate that the speed of light is constant, I take two parallel mirrors, I take a photon bouncing between them, and the photon between bounces, the time intervals are equal. That's the definition of equal intervals of time, because the speed of light is constant. Doesn't matter whether my frame is moving or stationary or whatever. So, that is the idea that he has got, and we know that once you have declared the speed of light to be a constant, the rest of relativity follows. In particular, it becomes a limiting velocity, in the sense that if I have some object or some reference frame which starts off with a speed less than that of light, it cannot reach that speed by any amount of acceleration. So he states that quite clearly. I think there cannot be a clearer statement than this, that no velocity could surpass that of light any more than any temperature can fall below absolute zero. It's a very clear understanding of theory of relativity. And he explains why that happens, because as you go on accelerating, the inertia increases. So you need to add more and more force to make it accelerate by the same amount, and it goes to infinity, so you can never actually approach the speed of light. And you can approach, you can never reach it. So the point is how he defines a clock. Let me just go over it once more, because there's this issue of local time, which is a little tricky issue. As he says that, why does this not represent a contradiction? It does not represent a contradiction because he says that the clock that the observer would use is a clock which marks what Lorentz had called local time. So this local time is something which was introduced by Lorentz. But Lorentz introduced it in a different way. And Poincaré understood that the local time as it is being used by Lorentz is metaphysical. And since it's metaphysical, he rejects it, and by defining the speed of light as constant, he has made that local time into a physical time. It's no longer metaphysical because the speed of light is constant. And therefore, the clock that you use with the bouncing photon will give you precisely what the local time of Lorentz. So he does say this sort of thing, that he has been quoted out of context by Abraham Pice, and therefore I am quoting this, that he says that this will not mark true time, they may mark what one may call the local time. But it matters little, since you have no means of perceiving what the true time is. Okay, he has given a definition. And so this is the way you define it. And doesn't matter what is this true time, we do not know what is true time, you cannot perceive it, there's no physics to it. It's a metaphysical concept, and local time is what you have by virtue of this definition in order to make the laws of physics or the equations of mechanics as simple as possible. So that's the idea. He has postulated the constancy of speed of light to provide a physical basis to local time. All right, now this leads to the theory of relativity. You don't need anything more. Once you have postulated that the speed of light is constant, everything else in relativity follows, and Poincaré derives it and he publishes it in 1905. This was done in 1904. And the theory of relativity is attributed to Einstein, whose paper came in 1905. But some people have objected. Everybody is not, in fact, Whittaker wrote this, he repeated it twice. Even in his biography of Einstein, which he wrote in the proceedings of the Royal Society, he pointed this out, that Einstein adopted Poincaré's principle of relativity using, Poincaré's name for it. Okay, so there's a little error. I thought I had checked it, but apparently I did not. Well, it is better than forgetting to bring the laptop altogether. So, which I did. Alright, so this is what Whittaker said, using Poincaré's name for it. Now that name is important. What does it mean? Because Poincaré had earlier used the term principle of relative motion. He said the principle of relative motion is what one has, and that is that was his term for it. And then he used the term relativity, principle of relativity, only in 19. I mean, this of course was known. The earlier work of Poincaré was known to Einstein. Einstein had read it, and this is on record. It's part of his Science and Hypothesis, which Einstein had read, definitely read. It is only in his 1904 paper that Poincaré uses the term relativity. So the substance of Whittaker's point is that Einstein had seen the 1904 paper. When he says he used the same word for it, it's not just that, well, it's a word which could have been used. So, if Einstein had seen the 1904 paper, well, there is nothing left to relativity after that. He did not acknowledge it. In fact, he could also have seen the 1905 paper, which had the formulae, but that is a further question. So, this is what he was suggesting. So, once he has postulated that the speed of light is constant, that it is a limiting velocity, that all of mechanics has changed, that it should be done like this, well, there is nothing more for Einstein to do except to take the credit. So Einstein also denied reading Lorentz's 1904 paper. He writes that in a footnote in 1922 that, of course, I was not aware of the preceding paper of Lorentz. But the strange thing is that Lorentz, what Einstein uses the term longitudinal mass. And this is a very strange term, which is introduced for the first time by Lorentz in his 1904 paper. And since it's such a strange term, because people have only heard of mass in Newtonian physics, so he qualifies it. I will say there is no other true mass, there is longitudinal mass, there is transverse mass. Einstein has no problem. He uses it as if it has been used for the last 20 years. He doesn't bother to explain it. So this is something very strange. It's a very strange term. It is used only in those 2 years. It disappears from the literature after that, because it has no significance. So, this is why should he use the same terms if he has not read the paper, something needs to be explained. Now, I want to go a little bit into the way in which people have later argued. Abraham Pais says that Poincaré continued to believe in a further hypothesis, that of ether, which is completely false. I do not understand how history of science can be written in such a blatant way. It's just completely false. And it's the exact opposite of it which is true, that it was Poincaré who rejected the ether and it is Einstein who continued to believe in it. So I'll just show what that means and what the implications for relativity are. So the term ether has two senses. One is that it denotes an absolute reference frame which you're using, where you're making your primary measurements. And the second is that it provides a means of contact between separated objects. So I have a charge here, something there, how does it interact? It interacts through the ether. And well, I should also say that it could interact through what is today called the field, which is substantially similar to the ether. So anyway, let's look at the ether for the time being, because the question is that of ether. Now, this ether is a very old concept. It's found also in Nyaya philosophy. The same word, sky is Akash. And, it is also found in what I call Aristotle of Toledo, that is 12th century or 13th century texts. which come after Toledo, but I won't go into that issue now. But the point is, it provides contact between separated objects, as in Descartes' notion of ether. So Einstein believed in this, because in 1935 paper, he says action at a distance is spooky, like Francis Bacon. That if I do not have contact and then I have some influence going from one to the other, that is spooky. No, it's only spooks who can do it. That is Bacon's doctrine. Or witches. So, but Poincaré doesn't, he clearly rejects it in both senses. He rejects it as an absolute reference frame. So this is a very simple thought experiment that he performs. So there are these two objects here. I'm sitting and I'm looking at them for 1 second. Now after looking at them for 1 second, I say, well, they're still there. That's not true, because the earth has moved. And so from this point to the previous point, it is some 30 kilometers. So I have moved by 30 kilometers. And then he says, how do you say it is the same? You cannot not only say it, but that statement has no meaning. How do I say it's the same point as what it was? I don't know. I can only say, relative to me, it's in the same place. I cannot say that relative to some absolute space, it is in the same space. Okay, same place. Now, you look at how he applies this to, supposing these are not just some neutral bodies, supposing they were two electrical charges. And if they were electrical charges and they are carried along by the motion of the earth, then they are parallel currents. And if they are parallel currents, then they should attract each other, according to electrodynamics. So, if that happens, you can measure that. And if you measure that, you would have measured the absolute velocity of these objects. Not velocity related to the sun or stars or anything, but absolute, absolute space. That is ether. So, as he says, you can't do that. It is very, you can't measure it. You say measuring velocity related to ether, that's not satisfactory. And if you do that, then your theory ceases to be refutable or falsifiable. That's the point he is making. That it no longer fears any contradiction. If you accept such an interpretation, if you allow ether, then you are making things metaphysical. You don't want it to be metaphysical. You can always find some other fluid, some third fluid, some ether 1, ether 2, ether 3, and so on. For example, field. And you can fill all the space with it. And then you can say, well, this is how things are happening. And then he refers to the Michelson-Morley experiment that this has led to negative results. That's not strictly true, but I won't get into the history of that just now, but maybe we can talk about it if somebody is interested. Now, he rejects ether in the second sense as well, of action by contact. This is very important, because Einstein does not reject it in that sense as we just saw. So, he gives a very interesting account. So, he says, does our ether actually exist? So, why do we believe in it? Suppose light is coming from a distant star to here. So it originated there many centuries ago, maybe millions of years ago. Now, in between, where was it? So it originated there and it reached my eye, but where was it in between? So it has to be supported by some material agency. Otherwise, it does not exist, because if it cannot have a location. And therefore, he says, the ether was invented, that it was in the ether. But now, what does it mean? Now, this is the most interesting part. What does it mean to say that this it is there in the ether? It means that I'm making a statement about physics. I'm making a statement about the mathematics of physics, and I'm saying that I must do physics using ordinary differential equations like Newton did. This is the statement, that the state of the world at the next moment is decided by its state now, not by its state millennia ago. This is the critical point, because if you reject the ether, then I have to say something happened million years ago on that star. As a result of that, something is happening to my eye now. But if I have the ether, then this light was there all along, and I say, well, this photon or whatever it was just there, just the previous 100th of a second ago or 1 millionth of a second ago, and that has influenced the state of my eye, not something that happened million years ago. And that means this is the very critical point which he understood, which Einstein did not understand. That if you have rejected ether in this sense, then you have to have ordinary differential, you cannot have ordinary differential equations anymore. That's the critical point. So if you reject ether in this sense, then he calls them equations of finite differences. Today they would be called functional differential equations. where this conference in Dresden, from where I'm just coming, they called it what? State dependent delay equations. Okay, so that is what they call them today. It doesn't matter what we call them, the meaning is perfectly clear what he's referring to. So the point is, he says that what is the function of ether in providing action by contact? It allows you to do physics in one kind of way using one mathematical machinery of ordinary differential equations. If you rejected it, you would have to say that the state now depends upon the state million years in the past, as it evidently does. So many stars are so far away. They are millions of light years away. So this is why ether was invented, and now the entire mathematics of it has been worked out, and I have explained because many physicists had a lot of difficulty in understanding it because they still continue to use the notion of the field precisely in order to avoid this. And the moment you reject the notion of the field, then you get into this, and this point is not clear. It has been, well, I think now it is clear to people. So if you reject this notion of action by contact, whether by ether or by field, then you arrive at functional differential equations. And if you have functional differential equations, the critical point is that you need knowledge of the past in order to decide the future. Knowledge of present alone is not sufficient. That's the critical issue. That the field or ether incorporates entire knowledge of the past into the present, sort of bundles it together, and that's not on. So here's a trivial example. Maybe I can just point out that this is the past portion that is being prescribed, and this is then the solution that is being developed. Now the value at the present instant at zero is the same for all these three, but the past histories are different, and therefore the futures are also different. So this is a very simple kind of equation of that sort, where you can see this. So this is the consequence of rejecting the ether, that you have these kinds of equations, and this is an aspect which Einstein never understood, not till the end of his life. So, well, in fact, he made a mistake. He never solved those equations. He came across those equations when he was doing the theory of relativity, general theory of relativity, using the many body problem, but he made a mistake about it. He thought that that's not of any consequence. You can just approximate one set of equations by ordinary differential equations of the kind that Newton used. Such an approximation is mathematically impossible. Why is it impossible? Well, what is being asked is very precisely something like this, that if I have a delay differential equation of this sort, that tau there is a constant for the moment, in general it would not be, can I just change it to an ordinary differential equation? The second equation is an ordinary differential equation. Can I approximate it? Can I say the speed of light is so large, it doesn't really matter. Just that tau is a very small thing, so it won't matter much. I can't say that. Why can't I say that? Because there's a qualitative difference. And the qualitative difference can be seen very simply, that ordinary differential equations are time symmetric. They do not discriminate between past and future. You can take knowledge of the present and calculate the future. You can also calculate the past. Whereas, if I have this kind of a delay functional differential equation, that is time asymmetric. So, you can take a very simple equation like this. I won't bother you with all the details. It's just that you choose your function bt in a nice way, and well, you can see the picture perfectly clearly. So what is happening here is now that I have three different types of past history, and they are all collapsing into one thing in the future. So from the past I am able to calculate the future, but given this portion of the future I cannot say where it came from. It's just impossible. I have given three, there are actually infinity of possibilities. This is just a simple case. So I cannot go back in time with these kinds of delay equations. The time asymmetric. So there's a qualitative difference. So, well, let me summarize that there are wrong historical beliefs about the origin of the calculus, and that led to the assimilation of Newton's error of making time metaphysical. Of course, Poincaré didn't look at that aspect of history. He just said, well, it is metaphysical. And there was a confrontation between electrodynamics and Newtonian physics. So he said, you have to discard Newtonian physics. You have to define time there. But now that went away because Einstein was credited with the theory of relativity, and he did not understand that functional differential equations have to be brought in, which Poincaré understood. And so because you have this wrong historical belief about the origin of the theory of relativity, therefore for the last century or so, functional differential equations have been neglected, and it's only now that they are being picked up last few years. Well, this book was written in 94, right? This was written in 94. And this made these points, and this was not noticed until very recently. So probably I should have marketed it, which I did not do. So anyway, even if you look at a very simple problem like the classical hydrogen atom, so you have proton and electron, every textbook says that is not possible to have. Electron will fall in. Every school textbook says that. It is wrong because they haven't solved the actual problem. It could not be solved to this date. What I did was to solve it without radiative damping, not with radiative damping. The radiative damping problem I have just resolved. The paper is on the archive. I did it with my son, so it is there, and maybe you can take a look at it. So it still has to be worked out with radiative damping. But the point is that without radiative damping, well, this is the argument that is given. You go to an inverse square law of force, Coulomb force between charges, and then you think it's like a miniature solar system, and therefore you say that circular orbits are stable, where there is no radiative damping, but it's electrodynamics, not gravitation. So if a particle is moving in a circle, it is accelerating. If it's accelerating, it must radiate energy. If it radiates energy, it must lose energy, and therefore it must fall into the atom. So that's the logic. That logic is wrong because you're not supposed to use the Coulomb force. Coulomb force is only something between static charges. These are two charges in motion. Just according to current physics, it's just not been solved properly. So this is the consequence of physics. For 100 years, nobody looks at it. 2004 to 1905 is about, well, to 1904 is exactly 100 years. Okay, well, if you try to bring in radiative damping, what happens is that there are runaway solutions. Again, for another 100 years, people have been trying to solve it. I haven't succeeded. So what I have done is given a way to solve the problem with radiative damping without runaways. That's a technical thing. I won't go into that. Paper is available on the archive. So what you need to do is, first case, forget about radiative damping. You can't use Coulomb force because that's electrostatic case. You have to use the full electrodynamic force between two moving charges. So that is given by a slightly complicated expression. This is a simplified form of that expression. There is, nothing too much to worry about except that it is a velocity dependent force. As you can see, there is a velocity coming on the right hand side. That's number one. And number two, what you have to worry about is that the past is coming in. That when I calculate the force due to one particle on another, I have to look at the past position of the particle too. So if I have these two particles, then I cannot look at its instantaneous position, I have to look at its past position. And likewise for this. So that's what this thing is doing. This term that is coming in is giving you the past. So that's a retarded time that is coming in. And that retarded time makes a difference. It changes the character of the equation. Bound to happen because the velocity of light is finite. So you cannot do it instantaneously. So the past has come into the picture. And then there is a question of how do you prescribe past history? Okay, so what I did was just started with Coulomb orbit. Of course, you can ask why you did that. You could do something else. Yes, you can do something else. So this is just the first time the problem has been solved. So I do not know what to do. So I just tried whatever seemed to me appealing. If something else appeals, well, we can do it that way. So the critical issue is that if you start with the Coulomb orbit, it doesn't stay stable. Doesn't stay stable because it gets thrown out. So even at this level, it is true that you do not have... So this is a very elementary consequence which has been neglected for the last 100 years. There is something called a delayed torque. Let me just show you a picture. that if you are looking at the full force, see, it's not acting instantaneously. So the line of action of the force does not pass to the center of mass. So I think I have a picture here. Yes, here's a picture. So the picture makes better sense. So if I'm looking at particle one here, so say there's the electron here and there's the proton, both are rotating about a common center of mass. This is going like this, that is going like that. So at this point, it doesn't see the proton here, the electron is seeing this here. So this is not passing through the center of mass, and therefore this force is not conservative. So angular momentum is not conserved, so it speeds up, the delayed torque. Now, whether it will be enough to make it, to prevent it from falling or not, is a separate question, technical question. Point I want to make at the moment is just this, that because of wrong history, the simple problem was not solved for 100 years, and all the textbooks are full of the wrong solution of the problem. Maybe it is eventually right, is beside the point. So the point is that after relativity, you have to do physics using these kinds of functional differential equations. There's no option. The other thing is to take one step beyond Poincaré. Ask what kind of functional differential equations. So now I have to look at the kind of functional differential equations that Poincaré solved, but I believe he solved some things for retarded gravitation. He was only looking at the possibility of delay. But I am saying there is one further requirement which needs to be, one further aspect of metaphysics of time which is in physics which needs to be eliminated, which is that people usually assume causality. Now, causality is a metaphysical requirement. Past is the cause of the future. Why? If I want to do physics, I must check whether this is so. And if I want to check whether this is so, I must construct a theory which does not assume that. And I must show that that theory is not in accord with experience. That would be the correct process. That process has not been followed. So what happens if you abandon causality? Well, nothing very much happens, nothing very catastrophic happens. So I want to look at, if you had things acting, I'm now taking instead of delay, I'm taking the case of advanced equations. This reference to entropy is probably it is meant to indicate that this sort of thing also resolves the paradoxes of thermodynamics. You know, if you look at thermodynamics, we see things happening every day. We see entropy increasing, and this cannot be explained in Newtonian physics. It can be explained by retarded functional differential equations. Suppose you had the reverse, a completely world in which future decides the past. So here I have prescribed some part of the future, I get the past, and now from past I cannot know the future, but from future I can know the past. It's just the time reversed. In this case, you would have entropy decreasing. So what is entropy decreasing? Why is it decreasing towards the future? Because entropy represents absence of information. So in the past here, in the future, I have more information than I have in the past. In the other case, it is the reverse, where in the past I have more information, I have less information about the future. So that's entropy increasing towards the future. Okay, but that's not what the world is like. So what the world is like is that, you would have something based on delay, but you could also have mixed time. So a little bit of interactions coming in from the future. If that happens, what do you expect? So, what you expect is something little strange. What you expect is now, the situation is that if I have a mixed type thing, I cannot simply calculate the future. I cannot calculate it if I give you the past. I cannot calculate it from the future. I cannot calculate back the past. And even if I prescribe both and future, I cannot calculate even the present unit. But to what extent can I not calculate? This depends upon how much of advanced interaction I have got. So if I have got a small amount of influence coming in from the future, then I can get some idea. I can roughly use the past to calculate the future, but only roughly. I cannot decide it precisely. It is not precisely decidable. So, well, there are these things. One is that, of course, people will say you should use quantum mechanics. The point is that the moment you have done this sort of a thing, you say that the world is non-unique, there is a structure to time. So, just as you have in the semantics of parallel processing, you need a different kind of logic. If you have a structure to time, you have branching processes and processes collapsing together, then you have a structure to time. The structure to time forces a different kind of logic, and that different kind of logic leads to quantum mechanics. So I will just give you a brief account. A detailed account is there in the book, and it is there also in the archive, that if you look at the corresponding temporal logic, that gives you a quantum logic. That's the precise statement. Okay. So that doesn't matter, it at least gives you all the qualitative properties. You saw that you're getting some of the quantitative properties as well. And it is not the same thing as the so-called many worlds interpretation, because the many worlds interpretation, worlds branch, they never come back. Okay, so you have a simplified account that's there in this book. And there's just a little, since you have the subject of how history distorts physics, this claim was repeated by Michael Atiyah, and it was called Atiyah's hypothesis in June 2006, that functional differential equations imply quantum mechanics. And of course, they did acknowledge this book and other things later on in 2007, but not quite. The point is that this is a mistake because there is no hypothesis needed. It doesn't have to be Atiyah's hypothesis or Raju's hypothesis. No hypothesis is needed. And I tried to ask the AMS to correct it. They said, no, we want to hang on to that mistake. So all right, let them hang on, what can be done. So now I just want to close with one last thing, which is this issue of spontaneity. The point is that with mixed tag FDEs, the future is not entirely determined by the past. It is determined partly, it is like a situation of what you have, what is called paticca samuppad. So you have conditioned co-origination, that the future is conditioned by the past, but things co-originate, they are not decided, it's not determined by the past. And those spontaneous processes create order. They are not chance, they are not chance processes, because chance processes will create disorder, they will increase entropy. So they are distinct from chance processes, and they appear to be inexplicable. Like, let us say a time traveler arrives right now, at this instant. Now, I cannot explain, and let us suppose this is the earliest moment of space-time, so this is the moment of the birth of the time traveler. There is nothing in the past which presages the arrival of this time traveler. I cannot explain it from the past. I can only explain it from the future. So from the past, if I go to explain, I will say spontaneously the molecules of air conspired together to create this human being. Whether or not that is possible to have time travel with machines like that, that he pressed the button of, I can explain from the future, that he pressed, in the future there was this time machine and he pressed the button and that's how he came here. But I cannot explain from the past. So from the past, I have to call it completely spontaneous. And the point is, it has created all. It's not a normal kind of a process, because molecules of the air will not normally conspire together to create such a thing, but it has created all. So these kinds of processes are possible on a very tiny scale. That's the idea. And this is the nature of the cosmos, that such processes exist. And that is what accounts for the existence of biological organisms. That it's not merely a chance process that some molecules came together, but there is a spontaneity which is there in the cosmos at a low level, which biological organisms or human beings can amplify in some manner. So that is the crux of the idea, that if you look at it properly, this is what happens. And so I will just give a recap.
Just 1 minute.
Because if I have this kind of a thing, it is not fully reversible. So the reversibility paradox is gone. The hypothesis of the Poincaré recurrence theorem also failed. So the recurrence paradox is also gone. So I can account for the increase of entropy that you observe. I can also account for the fact that there are processes or organisms which exist, which are able to create order in some fashion spontaneously, which are not determined from the past. So that's why it is a very good thing, and it accounts also for quantum mechanics. That's the idea. And so let me just conclude that Newton had certain religious beliefs about the perfection of mathematics that led to a wrong belief about nature of time in Newtonian physics. Now this was corrected by Poincaré, and but of course then there was a wrong historical belief that it was Einstein who discovered and not Poincaré who got the theory of relativity, and therefore for the last century these kinds of equations have been neglected. So they are a natural consequence of the theory of relativity. No further hypothesis is needed. And if you go one step further and also reject this notion of causality, which is again a metaphysical notion, you get a slightly different type of FDEs, mixed type FDEs. So they are very nice. You get all the qualitative features of quantum mechanics because you're getting a quantum logic out of it. Plus, they are better suited to describe biological organisms. So that's it. Thank you very much. And you can discuss. Yeah.
Yeah.